सदाशिव समारंभा शंकराचार्य पर्यंता वंदे गुरु परंपरा. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द सेकंड पार्ट ऑफ द डिस्कशन, अ डिफरेंट अप्रोच टू द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ गुणम. द लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट हाउ द गुणास कैन बी एनालाइज्ड ऑन द चैनल्स. वी आर गोइंग टू एनालाइज इट फर्दर एंड एनालाइज द स्रोतो दृष्टि विथ गुणम. We have understood that every structure is made up of snigdha and it is made up of snigdha and shita, maintained by optimum level of agneya. The snigdha nature is nothing but the prithvi and jala, which makes the whole body. We believe that srotomayam hi shariram, the whole body is nothing but the channels, various innumerable minute channels. These channels facilitates the free movement of the vayu and through which the nourishments carry from one place to another place. This is how dhatu parinama happens. This is how all our body functions. If any channel is blocked at one particular time or it has any kind of issues, we will have the problem of that particular organ. Just imagine a single channel in your body. It is made up of prithvi and jala, and there is a free movement of vayu through the sotas. This whole structure is maintained by optimum amount of agni. Now consider if agni is increased. When we say agni is increased, it is not increasing its own place. It is going outside its own place and then it is growing. What happens exactly in jwara or fever? So this heat actually starts melting. As we have seen in our last lecture, that how the ice cream melts in an inappropriate temperature or higher temperature, similarly the heat melts down this snigdha nature of the channels. With this, slowly the obstructions starts coming, and the movement of vayu, which was very easy before, was not possible anymore. Due to this, there will be a vimarga gamana of vayu. So vata, which is supposed to move through the channels, it starts moving backward direction or some other direction. Due to this, there will be a buildup of vata, which is shown or represented by shofa. So just imagine a single channel where the vata is blocked, it is building up, and then it is giving a pressure onto the walls of the channels, and then there is a swelling, which we consider as a shofam. It is local shofam. You can correlate it as traffic. Like if you're going to a particular place and if there is a traffic jam, it's an obstruction. So traffic builds up. What we do? We start taking a reverse direction, or we start taking some small roads or small pathways. So that means that we are not driving on our natural or normal road. We are driving the off road. And that is nothing but the vimarga gamana. So the movement of vata, which is supposed to go in a particular direction, it is going in some other direction. It can be anything. When this pressure builds up more than the limit, it will burst up the channels. It damages the channels, and thus it causes the prana. This is what we are trying to explain. So what is happening is, there is a heat which is increasing the body. The snigdha nature is melting, it is obstructing the channels, and when the channels are obstructed, the movement of vayu is also obstructed, the pressure builds up, and that damages the channels. So we are seeing a complex of jwara, shofa and vrana. You can understand that all the disease process happens in this three aspect: jwara, shofa and vrana. So we can say, in other words, that the disturbed agni, weak structure due to melted snigdha, and that causes the damage. So these three diseases are not very the diseases as such, but it can also be considered as the separate entity of disease process or separate stages of disease process. Interestingly, these are the diseases which was emphasized by Brihatrayas. Jwara is emphasized by Vagbhata, Shofa by Charaka, and Vrana by Sushruta. So you can say that all the three are very, very significant in their own manner. So this all disease process, how it is happening? So it all starts from the disequilibrium of doshas. We say drogasto dosha vaishamyam dosha samyam arogata. So whenever there is a disequilibrium of the doshas, there will be a disease. So what happens is always that the doshas get aggravated in their own place, in their own site, and due to various reasons like asatma indriyartha samyogaha pragya apradaha parinama. So due to any of these, the dosha gets aggravated in its own place and then it can go to the different place. This is very well explained by Sushruta in Kriyakala. Sanchayam cha prakopam cha prasaram sthana samshrayam vyakti bhedo and vyakti and bheda. So these are the six stages how the disease spreads. The most interesting part here is that whenever there sanchaya happens, it happens its own place. The next level is goes to the outside of its place. There is a prakopa, so it is aggravating. Then it's prasara, it starts moving in different places. Then there is the stage which is most important, which is called as sthana samshraya. Now what is sthana samshraya? Sthana samshraya means the aggravated dosha is lodging itself in its own, it's in certain place in the body. Where it will lodge? It will lodge in some particular channel. Which channel? Wherever it sees there is a weakness, there is a favorable environment. Just for an example, vata is aggravated. So vata, where it will get? It will aggravate it in the pakvashaya. When vata is spreading all over the body, it can cause various kinds of pain. Some people have pain in the neck, some people have in the back, some people have in the knees or anywhere else. So this pain they will get only wherever the weakness is there. So if a person is utilizing his neck so much, or his neck is stressed, his neck is weak, so he will get the pain in the neck because this vata, which is prakopa, prasara and sthana samshraya, where it is going and lodging, will be the neck. Similarly, a person who has injured his back, or in the back is very weak, this aggravated vata will go and lodge in the low back and cause the low back pain. So the doshas which is aggravating can go and lodge in the place where it finds it is suitable, and that is why we say that we have the problem of that particular system, we have problem of that particular organ. So the problem will not be from 1 or 2 days, it might be from many weeks, many months, many years, sometimes previous birth. So that particular place of your system is weak because of constant abuse or any other reason. Maybe you can say that ahita ahara and vihara, and because of that weakness, whenever there is a favorable environment, by our wrong activities and doshas are aggravated, or that is what asatma indriyartha samyoga pragya apradha or parinama, yes, by season also, and then you will start getting the pain. We have seen that whenever there is a vata kal, like now it is a varsha ritu, so in varsha ritu vata increases, so all the conditions of vata, a person is already suffering, he will find more difficult. It is only because that aggravated vata will trouble that particular weak structure more. So why the weakness is coming? It is only because the jvara has made that particular srotas weak, and because of that it is favorable for the aggravated doshas to act. Manifestation and progress of the disease. So we know that the structure is Shita and Snigdha, maintained by optimum level of Agneya. With high jvara, it starts damaging the structure which is Shita and Snigdha. When we say jvara, we don't mean as a fever. You may not have a temperature, but you might have a jvara of that localized region. You might have jvara systemically in the body. We have seen many people where patient will come and say that, oh, I am feeling feverish. He don't have a fever, his appetite is normal, everything is perfect, but he feels feverish. It is jvara, and when this continues, there is a depletion of snigdha in the body. So it is the only snigdha which is going away from the system, and when this happens, the body gradually becomes weak. Whenever snigdha depletes, the vata will increase, because when snigdha is going down, the ruksha is increasing in the system. We have a small arrangement of the things. We will try to understand this in a different manner. Consider your system as Shita and Snigdha. Shita is prominent, Shita and Snigdha is prominent. Now, in a natural state, Shita, Snigdha, Snigdha, Shita will be very, very prominent. If Jwara starts, the heat increases in the system, the Shita becomes little weak. So you see that in the second point we did, Snigdha Shita, that means Shita has become little weak. Then next, Ushna becomes prominent. So Shita is gone and Ushna, that is heat, is become more prominent. Still, the structure is a Snigdha and there is a small amount of Ushna in the place. When this heat continues, when this Jwara continues, Ushna becomes very prominent. And as Ushna becomes prominent, it will start weakening the Snigdha. So Ushna becomes stronger, Snigdha becomes weak. Slowly, this continues and Snigdha will disappear. Okay, Snigdha will disappear and it will be converted to Ruksha. Still, Ushna is there. There is no problem. Still, Ushna is there. Now, what happens is, as soon as the Snigdha goes away, the Rukshata will increase as well as Ushnata will also reduce, because Ushnata always requires fuel to burn. And when there is no Snigdha, there will not be Ushna left. So, it becomes Ruksha Ushna and then it becomes Shita Ruksha, it becomes cold. And then the Shita becomes more prominent. And finally, that is what we call as death. So, you see, the Shita and Snigdha is something which is health, and Shita and Ruksha, which is something called as death. And in between that, there is something called as Ushna Ruksha, which is disease. If we understand this idea very well, we can actually explain many, many diseases. We can explain many conditions of the patient. You'll be surprised to know most of our things, like for example, Ojas. Ojas is Shita and Snigdha. What is against Ojas is Visha, Madhya. What is Visha and Madhya? It is Ruksha Ushna. So any of the substance which is Ushna and Ruksha will be against the Ojas, will be against Shita and Snigdha nature of the body. That is why we always say, whenever the food is being given in Ayurveda, we say that the Madhuram and Snigdham, this taste should be prominent. So you should consume all the six tastes, but it should be prayo madhura. So that will be naturally the Madhura and Snigdha nature has to be more in your food, because this Snigdha is required in the system. If you don't have enough Snigdha, proper Snigdha, the Ushna will not survive, the Agni will not survive. So we can say there are two types of condition. Either Snigdha is too much or it is too less. That's it. Too less means it is going towards Ruksha, which is maintained by the optimum amount of Agni. So if we have too much of Snigdha, we have to take away the Snigdha from the body. If there is too less Snigdha, then we have to give Snigdha back to the system. This is how we can treat. And that is why we have two types of treatment, Santarpana and Aptarpana. Otherwise, we can say that Brahmana or Langana. So either we are giving the nourishment or we are taking away the nourishment. This is what is happening in the seasons. Adana Kala, Visarga Kala. Adana is taking away the energy, Visarga is giving back the energy. So all the Visarga Kala is going to give you Snigdha, whereas Adana is going to take away the Snigdha because of Ushna. Adana Kala means sun is near to you. Visarga Kala means sun is away from you. When sun is near to you, it will burn more Jala, it will reduce the Snigdha. That is why the body is weaker in Adana Kala, and that is why body is stronger in Visarga Kala. We can say that treatment is about clearing channels, establishing Agni, and either by removing or giving Snigdha to the body. So the Vikrit Snigdha can obstruct channels. Thus, even to do Brahmana, first Langana is done, just to ensure that channels are clear to carry out the nourishment. So whatever medicines we are giving, it has to travel through the channels. If channels are not perfect, if they are not clear, the nourishment will not flow. And that is the reason that always before doing the Brahmana, Langana is done. So that if there is any blockage, is there any Ama, is there any Vikrita Snigdha, it has to be cleared before giving the nourishment. If more Snigdha is depleted, more it will take to nourish back. It's so simple. So Snigdha can be of various degree. See, cooked rice is also snigdha. Milk is also snigdha. Ghee and taila is also snigdha. When we say cooked rice, if you see after the panchakarma, we do the samsarjana karma. Manda, peya, vilepi, yavagu, odhana. Yusha. So manda, peya, it is what? It is just snigdha which is introduced to the system. Very mild form of snigdha, which is very easily digestible. And next level, it becomes more thicker. So gradually we introduce to this thing that it is just like if you have a campfire and then fire is dying, you have a spark of the fire and then you put some small, very little grass and then you blow some air, then you put some more and then you can build a big fire. Similarly, we have to make the Agni by supplying a small amount of snigdha to the system. If that is done perfectly, you will be very, very, very perfect. I just want to remind you one thing. In Shuddha Rodha, it is told that when you are hungry or you are stopping your Shuddha, your hunger for a long time, then your Agni becomes weak. And there he says, Tatrayojyam lagosnigdham ushnam alpam cha bhojanam. See how beautiful. So it is not telling to give juice as usually people do after the hunger strike. He says, Tatrayojyam lagosnigdham ushnam and alpam cha bhojanam, very small quantity. This is how it should be. The Agni should be brought back. So, snigdha, if we have to introduce more snigdha to the system, it is chosen according to the Agni and degree of Ruksha. So, in Ayurveda, we have four types of snigdha, right? Ghritam, Tailam, Vasa and Majja. So, it can be given individually or it can be given in the combination. So, Ek Sneha, then when we have two, when we have one, Yamaka, when we have two, Trivid, when we have three, or Mahasneha, when we are mixing all four. So if we analyze the treatment protocols of all the diseases, they can be incorporated under six headings. It is beautifully explained by Charaka. That we'll discuss just next slide. You see, pure snigdha actually reaches every srotas. How it happens is snehapana and pedicure. If you see in the process, when you do snehapana, after the matra increases day by day, you can see the snigdha which is appearing on the skin, the oily nature of the skin. And you can see that oily nature is appearing in your stools. And then we say that, oh, it is Samyag Snigdha Lakshana. Similarly, when we do Pedichil or Kayaseka for whole body, after 4-5 days or 7 days, we see that oil starts appearing in the stools. When person goes to toilet, he sees the oil which is going. So the oil is traveling all the way from the skin to all the channels of the body. Similarly, the ghee which is given orally or oil which is given orally, it reaches all the channels, all the srotas of the body. How beautiful Ayurveda has thought. And in higher quantity, it cleans the channels. We say Uttama Matra is always Shodhana. So always, whenever we do Snehapanam, we should go to the highest level. And when Uttama Matra is given, it actually clears all the channels. And after you do Rasayana, it is beautiful. It will impart Snigdha beautifully to the system and person feels rejuvenated. In South India, there is a method, especially in this time which is passed at Karkata Masam in Kerala, where person undergoes Ayurveda therapy every year. We call it as monsoon treatment. And there is a fixed protocol where person will, you prepare, you make the body accustomed to the snigdha, and then lot of snigdha has been given to the system so that it absorbs, goes to all the channels. Then when all the doshas comes to the koshtha, it has been cleaned, and then rasayana is given, then nourishment has been given. It is told very clearly that once you do the shodhana, it is important to give the rasayana, it is important to give the nourishment to the system. That means what? We are replenishing the snigdha back to the system. This is what explained by Charaka in as a Shadvidha Upakrama. He says, langanam brahmanam rukshanam langanam brahmanam kale rukshanam snehanam tatha svedanam sthambanam chaiva janiye sava bishak. So the person who is treating, he should know all these six things. And if you observe closely, it is just six gunas. Langana, which imparts laghu nature to the body. Brahmana, which imparts guru nature. Rukshana, which makes the body dry. Snehana, which makes the body more snigdha. Svedana, which is ushna. And sthambana, which is shita. That's all. So if we know this perfectly, the six gunas perfectly, we are able to treat any condition. We are able to do panchakarma. For example, if there is too much of a snigdha in the system, what we'll do? We'll do ruksha, we'll do urdhvatara. If suppose there is stambhana, there is a shita in the body, what we do? We do svedana. If suppose there is a lot of weight body, gurutvam is more, we do laghu. If there is lot of laghutvam in the body, we give guru. So these gunas are only balancing act of the system. And we are very fortunate to know this, because then the if we understand these gunas, it is very easy for us to understand, to impart knowledge. In fact, all the medicines can be categorized like that. So even if you are giving a medicine for a single condition, there are many type of medicines. So you can actually understand the degree of which degree you want to give. I'll give a simple example. There is something called as Vidaryadi Gana. Okay, Vidaryadi Rayam Hridyo Vimano Vatapita Shosha Gulma Angamarda Urdhusha Sukas Harogana. Now this Vidaryadi Gana, when we give in a kashaya form, it is Brahmana, definitely. So when we give in a kashaya form, it is heavy to digest and it's fine. Same Vidaryadi Gana is given in the form of Lehi also. So then it is more nourishing, more, it becomes rasayana. After that, Vidaryadi Ghritam is also there. So I have seen in our practice that when we go in a gradual, when we decide the medicine and when we gradually introduce the kalpana to the patient, the result is very beautiful, because then he totally recovers from any chronic diseases, because we are gradually introducing the snigdha with the same medicines. So this is how the kalpana plays a very, very crucial role in imparting guna to the body. One more example I will tell you. Tikta Ghritam. So whenever you want to increase vatam in the system, it is best way to increase vatam is to give tiktam, because tikta increases vata. But vata cannot go beyond control. So that is why people, we give tikta ghritam. So tikta rasa is given in the ghee media. And if you do that, vata is under control. Vata is increased, but within a controlled manner. So how this treatment or medicine works? So we have developed a small understanding based on this same channel concept. Just imagine you have a single channel and there is a ushna nature of the srotas. The channels is hot, there is a jwara in the system. Agni is alpa, okay? Agni is low, but channels are hot. There is amavarana because agni is low. So there the snigdha which is melting, and then there is a mixing of pitta and kapha, pitta and shleshma, or you can say it is a vikrita snigdha. Because of this ruda dushti, there is a block and there is a vimarga gamana of the vata. So what to be done? So the first and foremost is that we have to digest this ama, then only medicine can act. Second, we have to improve agni, and third, we have to reduce that vidaha. So when we give the medicine, this is what we do. We improve the agni, we remove the ama, we try to clear the vidaha, and slowly the ushna nature of the srotas reduces and vata will start flowing gradually. Once the treatment continues, the whole ushna nature disappears and vata becomes in a normal direction. So anulomana gati of vata is very important. So whenever we see that there is an issue with the movement of vata, if it is going in a vimar gamana or pratiloma, then the vata anulomana medicines has to be given. So after, at this stage, then slowly we start imparting the snigdha nature of the system. So we know that if vata is restored, pitta is under control, agni is improved, and then slowly the snigdha can be given to the system. So usually in all chronic diseases, this particular problem arises where we have to give snigdha in a later stages. And you see that agni is established, and finally rasayana is advised, which helps to bring back the healthy shita snigdha nature to the system. So we always need to do shamana and shodhana. So dosha sometimes aggravate after doing shamana chikitsa. That is why I say if the proper shodhana is done, the dosha will not aggravate. Even with perfect food, that is hita food and hita ahara and vihara, the doshas may aggravate, like you may have seasonal change or something like that. So that is the reason that we have to understand the gunas, and we have to understand the nature of our food, nature of our activities, and nature of our surrounding. For a simple example, a person who eats perfectly healthy food, everything is good, but he walks too much. What happens? the Ruksha Guna will increase, the Vata will increase in the system, and Ruksha Guna will increase in the system. So though he is taking the Snigdha, it will not be comfortable. That is why you see, whenever the Vyayama is advised, it is said that Ardha Shaktya Nishevastu Balibhi Snigdha Bhojibhi. The person who is doing the Vyayama or exercise should do 50% of the capacity, because doing the Vyayama or exercise increases Vata. And thus the person who is stronger and regularly taking Snigdha food should do the Vyayama. So you see how beautiful explanation they are giving. Understanding the seasons from Guna perspective. So we understand that there are six seasons: Grishma, Varsha, Sharat, Hemanta, Shishira and Vasant. So we will try to understand these Gunas in the season. It's a very, very interesting concept. We know this: Chay Prakopa Prashma, Vayur Grishma Dishu Dishu, Varsha Dishu Tu Pittase, Shleshmana Shishira Dishu. So the same thing has been represented in this chart, where Vata is in the Chaya in Grishma Ritu, Prakopa in Varsha, and Prashma in Sharat. So one by one we will see how it happens. Okay. Before that, I would like to remind that Vata is Shita and Ruksha, Pitta is Ushna and Snigdha, Kapha is Shita and Snigdha. So we have to keep this in mind, and with this purview, we will try to understand the seasons. Number one, Grishma. So in Grishma Ritu, by nature, there is Ushna and Ruksha nature. It is end of the Adhana Kala, and then there is an accumulation of Vata, because Ruksha is there, but Shita is not there. So there is only accumulation. This Ushna and Ruksha nature is against the nature of Kapha, so that there is a pacification of Kapha. Okay. So in Grishma Ritu, there is Ushna and Ruksha. Now, we go to the next, Varsha Ritu. Now what is happening is, Ushna and Ruksha. Now suddenly the Ushna is changed to Shita because of clouds and rains and cold wind. So Shita and Ruksha, which is there in the early phase of the monsoon, and then Vata aggravates. We say Tada Adan Bale Dehe Mandagno Badidevuna Brishti Bhubashvato Yamla Paka Dushte Shaladivi. So in this season the Agni becomes very weak, everything becomes Amla, and mainly in the starting the Shita and Ruksha nature is very prominent, and that is the reason that Vayu becomes so disturbed in the body. Gradually when the rain continues, the water increases, the Snigdha nature in the whole environment increases, and in the later phase of the monsoon, it is Shita and Snigdha rather than Shita and Ruksha. This Shita and Snigdha nature at the end of the monsoon, it is actually a preparation for the next Ritu. So Shita and Snigdha, which allows the accumulation of Pitta, because Pitta is Snigdha, but it is Ushna. So here it is only Shita. So it is, there is an accumulation of Pitta and aggravation of Vata. Next to that is Sharad Ritu. In Sharad Ritu, when clouds disappear, environment is clear, there is a strong sun rays. So suddenly it becomes Ushna. Already there is a Snigdha in a liquid form, in a more liquidized form. And this Snigdha along with Ushna aggravates the Pitta. Ushna and Snigdha is opposite to the nature of Vata. Vata is Shita and Ruksha. Here we have Ushna and Snigdha, which is right opposite. That is why there is a pacification of Vata. So this is in the beginning, Ushna and Snigdha. So there is an aggravation of Pitta and the beginning of the Sharad. As the Sharad Ritu ends, gradually the Ushna becomes weak. The sun becomes away from us. So Ushna becomes weak and Snigdha becomes more solidified because of presence of cold. Then comes the Hemanta. In the beginning, the Shita is still weak because gradually we are entering to the cold, and Snigdha solidifies. So there is a Shita and Snigdha. This is the end of Visarga Kala, and there is a pacification of Pitta, because there is a presence of Jala. So Jala is not there because it is more solidified. Then the late winter, this is very interesting. So as the nature is changing, the Snigdha is solid. And the solid is something which is not available, just like in ice. You see, if you have water in your hand, the water can wet your hand. But if you have ice in your hand, it doesn't wet. It is something like ice. The Snigdha is very strong. And that makes the things Ruksha. So Shita and Snigdha, Snigdha in a solid form, which represents in the Shishira Ritu, and here mostly the nature becomes more ruksha because of extreme snigdha. Okay, always remember there's an understanding that whenever one guna becomes extreme, it starts showing the property of other. We know that extreme cold is hot, extreme hot is cold, something like that. And then here, because of Shita and Singha, there is an accumulation of kapha. Then comes the most promising season, which is called as Vasanta Ritu. Now, Vasanta Ritu, what happens? The sun starts becoming stronger, and because of this, the body starts melting the snigdha. Whatever the snigdha which is accumulated in the winter, that is in Hemanta and Shishira, it starts melting. Just like an ice cream, you have ice cream in your refrigerator, you take it out and it starts melting. Or ice cream, ice, it starts melting. Similarly, our body starts melting the kapha because of heat, because of ushna. And here, the point, because all over the globe in the spring, people have many kinds of problems, viral fevers, cold, cough, flu, and I don't know what not. Some enthusiastic people start taking trikatu. Some people say something, but we forget that this is the melting of kapha. So if you increase ushna nature in the system, in your body, it will melt more kapha, it will trouble you more. Initially, it will give you some relief, kapha is better. But later, it will start troubling you. So we have to control all three, vata, pitta, kapha in this concept. So if you give some medicines which has both actions, that is vata also, pitta also and kapha also, then it becomes a very appropriate thing in the Vasanta. But the point is that in Vasanta Ritu, that kapha which is melting has to go out of the body. And that is the reason that acharyas advise to do vamana in this season. Because when all the kapha goes out and you feel fine. So snigdha, what happens? It goes out of the body, it removes and it dries. And then there is again, ruksha nature which is prevalent. And that is where we get back to the Grishma Ritu. After Vasanta, Grishma Ritu will come. So again, there is a Ushna and Ruksha. So this is, see how beautifully the seasons can be explained on the basis of gunas. And it actually happens. So every season, there are three seasons where we are supposed to do the Panchakarma. So in Varsha Ritu, we can do Vasti. In Sharad Ritu, we can do Virechana. And Vasant Ritu, we can do Vamana. Because the prakopa of vata, pitta, kapha is prominent in these three seasons. Whatever we do, we have to do treatment of agni. If a snigdha is less, providing fuel in the form of degree varies. So there we have to give tatra yojyam lagu snigdham ushnam alpam cha bhojanam. So always remember that no agni can survive without the fuel. Our body is also like that. And that is why we have to give proper snigdha, should be available to our agni to sustain. If snigdha is more, ruksha and ushna can be given, like maricha or shunthi. So it depends that what is bothering the agni. If snigdha is too much, then you have to take out the snigdha by giving ruksha and ushna. If snigdha is less, then we have to give snigdha to give fuel to the agni. So, as we know that there are three stages of treating ama: langana, langana pachana, and dosha avsechana. So if agni is troubled a little, you can just do langana, don't eat anything, just do a fasting, and agni itself will start using this vikrita snigdha and things will become clear. If it is not happening, then we have to give some support of medicine, that is langana pachana. You can give shunthi. So when you give shunthi, it helps to improve the agni and digest the ama, that is reduce the vikrita snigdha. And if it is too much, then it will not help. Then we have to forcefully take out the excessive snigdha. So if pitta is more jala in agni, ruksha shita is given to reduce jala and to improve agni. And again, if snigdha is less, tikta is to be given in a ghee medium. So ghee is the best, as it is Shita, Snigdha, Agneya at the same time, and it is also Deepana. It is a very similar nature to the Ojas. It is said that cow's ghee, cow's ghee, Goghrita, is the best which can be used to improve nourishment to the Ojas. So we can say that everything is actually Snigdha. Presence of optimum Agni maintains it. If it is more, it turns Snigdha to Ruksha by reducing the jala. Similarly, more snigdha and weak agni will create vikrita snigdha like ama. So the perfect health is when a person is having prakrita snigdha maintained by optimum agni and appropriate movement of vayu in normal direction. So this beautiful understanding of gunas, if we are very convinced, we can apply in every aspect of our life. And believe me, there is only one factor, which is snigdha, which works. There is nothing else. If snigdha is proper, maintained by proper agni, all other factors you can explain. But either snigdha is less or snigdha is more. That is why you either you give snigdha or you take away snigdha. And that is why we have dvidhobha karmaniya. Either we are doing brahmana or we are doing langana. We are doing apatarpana or we are doing santarpana. That's it. So all of our treatment protocols, medicines, therapies, they are actually doing this only. Either they are santarpana or they are apatarpana. So in this purview of snigdha, if we understand the world, it will give a very, very good insight, and we can make wonders in our practice. So thank you so much.